Ông quý chồng. Ông chúng ta phải cầm to cái chấm đá ca để tiếp thị tham đá ca. Hay một nộp đòi về cả chung từ lúc mới tìm vì bây giờ có bê xuống đến đầu chấm buộc hẳn lại chấm liếng. Ông chấm ra. Đời miền thầm nào xong, một thay một bê lìa vì phía kỳ mới tìm vì ca phía khách đấy. Ông chấm ra, xong rạch. Rùm bê lìa một thay 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 nguồn chí cứ nơi bực ní đại ông nhầm ra nâng bình dìa bì thư sạm nà cá là hốt đò trâm mong đọc muối nâng sai sạp rạm này tì đại lấy mê tử vi ca bì cơ đầy khi xung phón cứ miên bì mùi vẹn này hay nây sạm nà cá sạp thay cầm sạp nẹ chùm mê rùm ní cứ nơi trong còi phía kỳ đồ tê tiết này đường cơ đầy tổn nếp đọc đi ca chung tư mê tử vi bây giờ cục bế nà mê mê tò ca tăng xung vốn đánh đào dịp vua ແລະអ្នកជំនាញបាទសូមបញ្ជាក់ផងថាមេធាវីការពារក្តីខេត្តសំផនគឺផ្ដល់ពេលវេលាមួយវគ្គសនីសម្មនាការគឺចុងក្រោយបងអស់នៃភាគីចុងក្រោយគេបងអស់មានមួយវគ្គហ្នឹង
And just to be sure, Mr. President, I would have half hour after the afternoon.
That means I have to skip a few subjects.
Mình đang chăng thế? Anh miền ao đi đào thêm mùi vẹt thế? Dương phát đào chun lúa cứ trâm mong đọt muối nắng sai sập ram để tì bê bê lia lúa sao mẹ bê tơ bi cà pê cái đây nuôn chi ở tâm đằng ấy buồn vẹt hời sao mẹ bê tơ bi cà pê cái đấy sao xong buồn vẹt dương phát đào ao buồn vẹt hời đầy lấy mùi vẹt sao mẹ bê tơ bi cà pê cái đây khi sầm phón cứ phe kỳ mà kháng pram vẹt hời chấm này ai phe kỳ đầu tê tiết dương ở toàn vì nứt lạt tập hiệp đấy bởi vì ở miền toàn miền sầm ná tam than tập hiệp chạy sao đấy dương phát đào
Unfortunately, Mr. Morris, that means I have to drop even more. Mid-February,
fourth meeting,
to you.
This is February 78. Look, I'm sorry, it doesn't refresh my memory.
Okay. That's no problem. Let me move on to my next subject. One of the very interesting findings, and I referred to it already earlier in your book, is, for instance, on
Page 0102, 1762, reference to
being our men. For instance,
Jia, Leon or Lezon, Le Yuan says the same ban thing in 1976 and he repeats it in 1978. Nuon Chia is our man and my personal friend. Nuon Chia is a person who feels sympathy for Vietnam. My first question when you read this in the archives, was this the only thing that you saw that was said about Nuon Chia and also about Sopin?
Yes, what I quoted in my book is everything that I saw. Had I found any more, I probably would have cited it too, because it was very striking, ironic, and indicative, in my opinion, of the Vietnamese misunderstanding and miscalculation.
I think it was for everyone in the courtroom, so not only me. But I hear myself now, so, I think it's fine again, thank you. Sorry, you were interrupted. Could you repeat your answer, please?
The quotes that I provided in my book are everything that I would have seen. Had I seen more, I would have probably almost certainly quoted them as well. I found the Vietnamese comments strange and reflective of a misunderstanding of the real political situation inside Cambodia.
History proves your words right when it comes to Nuon Chia. But do you have an explanation as to what made Pham Van Dong and Le Duan say that Nuon Chia and also something is our man, is a person who feels sympathy for Vietnam?
I think it's probably because of, as I understand it, Nguyen Chia's and Suu Kyi's presence in North Vietnam during the 1950s. And if that's correct, if I'm correct in that, that therefore the period of time there may have indicated a sympathy towards Vietnam, which the Vietnamese mistakenly concluded persisted long after those early contacts.
What makes you say that also after 1975, there weren't any contacts between Vietnamese on the other hand?
Well, I'm not aware of contacts.
No, I understand. But let me ask you the following question. If there were strong contacts between the Vietnamese Politburo members on the one hand and Suu Kyi and Nguyen Chia on the other hand, would you agree with me that would provide Nguyen Chia with a formidable intelligence position as to the implementation of Vietnamese ambitions?
I'm not sure that it would because of the fact that the Vietnamese are very, as I pointed out, very evasive and often deceitful with regard to their intentions.
pian ko do chea leak bang ampi chetana robas khluon hai khnyom mon dang tha ta Vietnam mien tam neak tamneung yang mich
person ba mien tang sao phom hai nang would have revealed what the Vietnamese intentions were
pu ke na bang hai sao phom nuon chea yang mich
te I'm saying it's not inevitable khnyom mon ai
ti ai sma da ko khnyom mon ai prama mue da man te
All of a sudden, I'm thinking about, I cannot find it right now, but I will get the exact quote later. In Chanda's book,
the brother
of Heng Samrin, Samrin, is being quoted as saying, Pol Pot simply knew too much. He was always one step before.
Before, that's why there's no citation.
Contemporaneous documents you studied them. But is it impossible
that
the standing committee of the formidable intelligence positions when it came to Vietnamese plans
and
It's possible.
Thank you. Now let me move to another subject, which is of course a central issue in your book.
And I would like to, at one point in time, go through it with some
contemporaneous documents from the UK that you do not know, but I would like to show them to you. Mr. President, I have prepared a binder, a small binder, with a selection of contemporaneous
documents
relating to DK's conflict with Vietnam.
Let me read for the chamber
which documents are using, and meanwhile, maybe you can have a look at these documents. These are the minutes of a plenary meeting of the vision at 9:20 on the 7th of September 1976. Document 2 is E3/221. These are minutes of a standing committee meeting entitled Examination of the Reaction of Vietnam in the 5th meeting. The document 3 is Revolutionary Youth E3/489, Uncle 89 being Son Sen, 23rd of January 1976. Document 5 is E3/884, a report from Chin to Office 81 of 30 August 1976. Document 6 is E3/882, a report from that same Chin to Office 81 12 August 1977.
I guess document 7 is E3/994.
It's a report from Rott, brother,
Bong,
12 August 78. E3/94.1 is document 10, which is a written record of interview of Mies Woon, 20 January 2014. And finally, document 11, E3/8752, which is the DC camp interview of Mies Woon. I will be returning to the documents shortly. Mr. Expert, I would like to discuss with you now, also on the basis of these documents, DK's reactions
towards
one of the central positions in your book, that is DK's reaction to Vietnamese encroachments. Incursions into DK territory. Can you describe how in your book you qualify DK's behavior toward the encroachments on their territory?
Are you referring to the end of 1977 or 1978? There were disputes about territory between Vietnamese and the Cambodians, which go back a long time. You're asking about the DK reaction. I'm not aware of, after early 1975, of major incursions of Vietnam until the end of 1977, major incursions.
Let me see if I can assist you a bit. In your book, for instance, on 01-001779, you say that you talk about, quote unquote, the bizarrely aggressive behavior of the Cambodian regime. On page 01-001674, Cambodia, quote unquote, initiated conflict. In relation to Vietnam's policy or implementation of policy. Vietnam, can you tell us what your central position is in your book?
I argue that in April 1977, the DK attacked a Vietnamese village, causing a substantial number of civilian casualties. And again, in September of 1977, a similar act occurred, which I believe was reported by also Nayanchanda, or Nayanchanda was taken to see the results of that attack, which killed a lot of Vietnamese civilians. My view is that these attacks were provocations which reflected an irrationality because of the fact that Cambodia, Democratic Kampuchea, militarily was much weaker than Vietnam. And there seemed to me to be no purpose in attacking Vietnamese territory, which could be defended. In other words, what I'm saying is, I'm not sure what interests were served by them doing that. I don't understand the interests that were served by doing that, and moreover, I believe that it made the Vietnamese communist leadership more determined to do something about Cambodia's leadership.
One is how is it possible for a political scientist as yourself
to conclude that
detainees
was
bizarre, irrational,
etc.
If you haven't extensively studied contemporaneous decay documents. You speak about a 30 April 1977 attack. Isn't it true that you're only basing your opinion on your conclusion? What had led up to that attack, if it ever existed?
Yes, it would be true that I'm not aware of what may have led up to that attack, if some events did take place which led up to that attack. Sorry, just let me just say one thing. If there were events leading up to that attack, that is provocations on the Vietnamese side.
Of some
attacking Vietnamese villages seems to me to be not the appropriate response.
That is certainly up for debate, and I'm very interested in the question. Before I go to the actual documents, let me refer you to what Douglas Spike said in November 78 before the U.S. Congress. He also, at the time, obviously not in possession of any DK internal communication documents. And this is what he said at E3/07/87/369/6 it's from that same excerpt on conclusions that I read out to you before. And he says, under point 5, the present border war, this document from November 78, the present border war, which is actually intertwined or seen, that's how I pronounce it, communist conflict, has been going on since at least 1970. Neither side can be condemned as instigator, neither is simply a victim. And then, most importantly, point 7, Cambodian behavior in the war is not as irrational as it appears. There's logic both to Cambodian strategy and rhetoric, particularly when viewed in the light of
chấm bù cao cầm riêng cầm hai bây giờ bây giờ mưa tên lửa bộ vật tất xa
quát maybe I'm wrong to go into a different direction as to DK's behavior in reaction
cái thảo vì ai thắc nhầm để dự khóa ông bì ạ cặp kê giá cơ đôi tích đào đồng bọc cầm bì chìa bì chìa thập tay chấm bù Việt Nam có bần tay bì ạ chứ ca thâm trời tế
Yes, it is correct. But just to go back to your early question, part of my reaction to DK behavior and my conclusion that it was irrational goes back to the period 1970 to 75 during the war against the Lon Nol government. And at that time, the DK forces came to the conclusion that Vietnam was the number one enemy. Whilst objectively speaking, trying to put oneself in the shoes of the DK, I would not think that Vietnam was the number one enemy. It may be an enemy, but not the number one enemy. The number one enemy was the Lon Nol government, who they were attempting to overthrow and to have tried to drive the North Vietnamese forces out of Cambodia when the North Vietnamese forces were helping the DK forces, as they later came to be known. The insurgency led by Pol Pot to try and drive the Vietnamese out of Cambodia at the same time as Vietnam was assisting the Khmer insurgency seemed to me to be irrational. So there was a pattern which I applied in my thinking about what happened in 1977 and 1978. There is other evidence in the book, as you know, which, for example, talking about Ignoring the disparity of strength between Cambodia and Vietnam in terms of armed forces and so on. I go into that in quite a lot of detail. So my conclusions about irrationality in these particular cases are not based on those particular cases alone.
Before I go to documents that I just handed out to you, and we believe strongly contest the irrationality of certain behavior. Let me first read to you Vietnamese ambitions and its implementation. This is something he said in January 1978. That was a speech of Nguyen Chia celebrating the visit of Zhu Enlai's widow, Cambodia early 78. It was right after the cutting off of the diplomatic relations with Vietnam. Mr. President, English year and S000683 French S006872705 Khmer 006506. This is what Nguyen Chia says. Our Cambodian people always make efforts to have close, friendly relations with all countries, far and near, based firmly on the principles of respect for each other's independence and territorial integrity, non-interference in each other's internal affairs, non-aggression, equality and mutual benefits, and in line with the policies of independence, peace, and non-alignment, as indicated in the Constitution of Democratic Cambodia. However, our Cambodian people will struggle resolutely against the acts of sabotage and subversion from within, aimed at staging a coup d'état to topple Democratic Cambodia against the mid-acts of the Khmer Rouge, and all acts
Some sort of people.
I would agree that it appears that way.
I was
expecting that answer, and
that will bring me now to leading you to those documents.
If you could have a look with me to the first document. I've highlighted the relevant excerpts for you. Mr. President, first document, ESP 799, English ERN 00184777, French 00223314, and it's a small document, 2 pages. Here is Son Sen, the chief commander and member of the standing committee, addressing members of Division 920 on the 7th of September 1976. You agree with me, I'm sure, that this is a document which was absolutely an internal document which was not supposed to ever go out. It did. Here he says the following, page 5, our revolution is a socialist revolution and already is a deep one. So toward Vietnam, we take the following stances. We won't be the ones who make trouble. Two, but we must defend our territory, absolutely not let anyone take it or violate it.
Three,
if Vietnam invades, we will ask them to withdraw, and if they do not withdraw, we will attack. I realize this is the first time you see this document. But what would be your first reaction?
Well, I mean, I can only take it at face value.
And
I don't know the context in which it was issued, it suggests that there were not serious problems between the two countries at that time. But there was a fear that there could be problems between the two countries in the future.
I understand. I'm asking you face value. That's not easy. In terms of foreign policy, military policy toward Vietnam at that time, does this sound to you in any way irrational, bizarre? Now let me move
to the
incidentally, I would like to say that people who behave bizarrely or irrationally don't necessarily behave bizarrely or irrationally all the time.
To show you there's consistency. Mr. Morris, there's document E3221, your document 2. Here again it's Son Sen talking. This time not vertically, but really horizontally to his direct peers in the standing committee. Present Our client Nuon Chia.
គឺថាគូចំហររបស់នួនជានិងប៉ុលពត
អ
ៀងសេរី
វ៉ុនវ៉េត
វ៉ុនវ៉េត
ឃ្យូសំផន
ហើយនិងឃ្យូសំផន
Comrade Ya from the northeast. And here's what he says
when
he discusses the border problem. And I would like you to go to the green or the part that I highlighted. Mr. President, that is ERN 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003 0003
ន្តចូលមកអត់ឈប
់
យើងមិនចង់បង្កបញ្ហាជាមួយពួកគេទាល់តែសោះយើងតាមបទពិសោធន៍របស់យើងប្រសិនបើគេចូលហើយប្រសិនបើយើងមិនដេញទេគេមិនទៅទេប៉ុន្តែប្រសិនបើយើងតឹងតែងគឺពួកវាទៅនេះគឺវាកាលានៅរតនគិរីនិងមណ្ឌលគិរីគឺនៅរតនគិរីនៅមណ្ឌលគិរីយើងមិនវាយប្រហារជាមួយពួកវាទេគឺយើងគោរពទៅតាមបញ្ជារបស់បកហើយមិនឲ្យមានភាពតានតឹងកើតឡើងឡើយសូមចាប់កណ្ដោសរង
There are some interesting other excerpts
but I'm going to try to read it myself to that one. Again, same question, does it seem like he was irrational? I'm going to try to read it myself to that one. I'm going to
try to read it myself to
that one.
But I'd like to have more context on who they are, whether they are Vietnamese forces or whether they are civilians from Mondokiri, because as you, I'm sure know, civilian populations of the Cambodian side and the Vietnamese side near Mondokiri, Ratnakiri would have a lot in common. And whether this is considered to be violations by civilians, by state officials or by soldiers, seems to me to be an important issue.
ដូច្នេះភាពខុសគ្នាគឺខុសគ្នារវាងទាហានហើយនឹងជនស៊ីវិលមេធាវីខ្ញុំយល់តែវាមានឯកសារជន់ខ្ពស់ក៏ដូចជាឯកសារថ្នាក់ទាបផងដែរ
ឥ
ឡូវនេះ
ខ្ញុំនឹង
បន្តទៅឯកសារទី3គឺឯកសារ
គឺជាសម្រាប់
ដែលដកចេញពីទស្សនវិស័យយុវជនយុវនារីបដិវត្តន
៍ដ
ែលអង្គរំកម្មភិបាលខ្មែរ
គឺជាឯកសារ
ខែសីហាឆ្នាំ75
3/3/79
3/7/49
Merci monsieur le président juste une question pour comprendre l'exercice
ខ្ញុំមានសំណួរមួយដើម្បីឲ្យយល
់ពីចំណុចនេះprésenté par le conseil de Munchia ont été envoyés à l'expert avant
ដែលលើកឡើងដោយមេធាវីនុមជានឹងត្រូវបានផ្ញើជូនទៅដល់អ្នកជំនាញតាំងពីមុនមកទេមុនពេលគាត់មកផ្ដល់សិក្ខាកម្មនោះឬក៏គាត់ទើបតែឃើញឯកសារនោះនៅពេលនេះតែម្ដងយើងបានពិនិត្យមើលនៅក្នុងបញ្ជីឯកសារដែលបានផ្ញើដោយមេធាវីនុមជាហើយហើយខ្ញុំមើលទៅឃើញថាដូចជាអ្នកជំនាញគាត់ទើបតែដឹងពីឯកសារនឹងនៅពេលនេះទេអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំចង់ដឹងថាតើមេធាវីមានបានផ្ញើជូនគាត់ពីមុនមកទេ
I'm sure Mr. Morris is able to give the answer himself. I think this is the first time that you see some documents, correct?
Correct. This is the first time I've seen these
documents.
Which is that I haven't intervened earlier because with this expert that don't have a big problem. But if you feel uncomfortable to give an answer because you would need to read the whole document, you tell us please. But I certainly leave that to you.
And if I may follow up on this, Judge Fens, I was under the impression that I would be able to question until 2, and I had planned to give the documents to him in the lunch break. Revolutionary Youth Document 3, English year 0053 2686 Khmer 0039 1114 French 0059 It is instructed to all youth cadres. Along the borders, it is imperative to be vigilant and not to do anything to cause trouble with the foreign neighboring people. However, it is also imperative to absolutely defend and counter and not allow them to violate or insult the nation in our country. This is an instruction which of course goes much broader. Again, on the face of it, does that seem to be an irrational instruction to young
Congress?
No, it doesn't seem to be an irrational instruction to young
Congress.
I want to emphasize, though, to you and to the court that time period which the document refers to, 1976, if I'm not mistaken, this is issued from August 75, actually. This was not a period of which I regard as high tension between the two countries. There was some tension over the islands, some islands, disputed territory. But this was not the period in which there was very high tension, which from my analysis, began in 1977.
We do have documents from that period as well.
Let me see if I can move on to the next document, document 4, which is for U4, which is E3/887. This is actually, as I said earlier, an instruction or telegram going from down upward. You can see it is written by 05, that is Commander Sarun. I think I said it correctly. It is directed to Uncle 89, that's a code name for Son Sen. English ERN, that's only one page, English ERN 00185223, Khmer 00021, French 00083096. This is what he writes to Son Sen. In the night of 22 January 76, the VSS came to our camp at the front and at the back, attacking our patrol guards. 3. We have not attacked them. We still negotiate firmly, because that is our land. 5. I'm organizing the forces while testing and waiting for the final decision from the party. As in the above report, request to attack any place where there are Vietnamese. Only if they are in the Cambodian land, I will attack them all. But there has been no final decision from Ankara. I implemented in a way politically mature, but trying to tolerate it. We have not counterfired even a bullet, while we are waiting for Ankara's advice first. We have not fought back yet. Again, I understand first reaction. Does that sound like out of control, irrational behavior on the actual border between Vietnam and Cambodia?
No, it does not.
Let me take one document, and then I have to finish, I'm afraid. This is also a very interesting document because it talks about negotiations as well. It's document 5 for you, E3/884. Let me guide you through it. It's
in
Our people and Revolutionary Army has a good and pure will toward the people in Vietnamese Army, who is a neighbor. We do not wish to have any conflict with Vietnam. Through my observation of past events, when Comrade Vietnamese invaded us to a certain extent, Comrade always alleged us first that we had invaded Comrade to this and that degree. For us, we would like to reaffirm that we will not violate anything, even a small thing belonging to Vietnam. However, we will always absolutely defend our independence and territorial integrity based on the current border. And then further down, paragraph 3, where he says, we take assumptions on Vietnamese main aims that the state of not stopping provoking border conflicts is also directly meant to delete or avert the public attention to severe situation provoked by Vietnam. Again, first reaction.
This must be taken in the context of what was happening on the ground at the time, and I simply do not know whether the events described at the beginning of the document, the events described actually took place or not, that would determine whether I thought it was irrational or not. There's nothing in the words that is irrational, obviously.
I understand. Let me move away because of time from these documents and go back to an area that you are well familiar with. Can you describe Cambodia's or DK's foreign relations with Thailand, or because of time, let me go straight to the point. Isn't it true that from 77 and 78, Thai neighbors
I think that one can't draw too many conclusions from the initial Thai reaction to fighting on the border between Cambodia and Thailand, which took place in 1978. The Thais are not people who are belligerent and aggressive. They don't like to resolve conflicts by force necessarily. They prefer to try and negotiate settlements. I think that they initially probably thought, as reasonable, that there may have been some local commander who was acting on his own, but the consistency and persistence of these attacks against Thailand in 1976 would have caused the Thais to eventually regard this as somehow or other a central policy. I'm not sure how far there were instructions from the center to the border areas to carry out these policies, but it seems strange that they persisted if there was not some kind of central authorization to carry out attacks against the Thais.
Well, let me read back to you what you wrote yourself.
English ERN 0100174 we discuss these border troubles.
I
quote you, the two most important Thai government leaders refused to attribute blame to the DK leadership in Phnom Penh. On page 0100174, Thai Foreign Minister Pacharyan Khan at a banquet talks about
but
from quote unquote a third party. Chanda is saying that at one point after the Vietnamese invasion, as he says, Bangkok was scared that the tanks would go further, even to Thailand.
So if you compare the situation
with Thailand to Vietnam, wouldn't you agree with me that in relation to Thailand, DK's behavior was very rational?
I don't necessarily agree. At a time when DK was involved in a very serious conflict, large-scale conflict with Vietnam, the last thing they needed was to have a conflict with their Western neighbor. And if, in fact, there had been local commanders carrying out provocative acts against Thailand, I would have thought that the central authorities in Phnom Penh would have shut that down immediately. And I'm surprised that they didn't, and that's why I regarded their persistence in these attacks as somehow or other reflection of attitudes from the central command. As for the Thai attitude, I think I answered that earlier. The Thais went out of their way to try and avoid conflict. That's their way of behaving in foreign policy, their conflict avoidance people.
Again, a very interesting topic that I would like to discuss with you further, but I'm afraid I cannot. Let me move away to another topic that I would briefly like to touch upon. Throughout your book, you refer to the CPK as not only Maoist, but even hyper-Maoist. I'm not sure what that is, but can you explain why it is that the CPK is Maoist? And if you can also take into consideration what Heather called the myth of the CPK being Maoist.
I think that the Communist Party of Cambodia was Maoist in its orientation because a lot of the domestic policies of democratic Cambodia were in fact modeled on the Great Leap Forward, taking people to the countryside from the cities. Emphasis on manual labor as a form of personal liberation. These things were ideas of Mao Zedong. I believe that the reason I use the word hyper-Maoist is because Democratic Kampuchea's leadership felt that they should go faster and further than Mao did in China in attempting to achieve what they considered to be a pure communist state. There was a sense, a frantic sense, of need to go faster and to create what the DK leaders thought would be the purest form of communist revolution. So I don't know that there's what Hedder is referring to as the influence of the Vietnamese on the Cambodian communist movement to some extent, I think that there was a Vietnamese influence, but I think that the Maoist influence was more important.
My client is not sitting here, and of course I'm not allowed to testify on his behalf, but he would be very upset if he were ever to be called a Maoist. Let me refer to make my point to an important Vietnamese ideologist, Trong Chin. Can you tell the chamber who Trong Chin was, and what was, how would you describe the way he saw Marxist-Leninist ideology?
Trong Chin ni kot yul khoi rubiep na chompu mnok Kampuchea robos Mak Lenin nu.
Trong Chin was a member of the Politburo of the Communist Party of Vietnam. Trong Chin's Vietnamese for Long March, indicating an affinity for Maoist China. Trong Chin was the Secretary General of the Party during the time of great Chinese influence over the Vietnamese in the early 1950s. After the so-called land reform, which was in fact a terror campaign initiated by the Vietnamese communists against their civilian population, after it got out of hand and led to an uprisings in parts of Vietnam, Trong Chin was demoted from the position of Secretary General largely blamed. So he was probably the man most connected with China in the Vietnamese leadership. The Vietnamese leadership, from my studies, was always factionalized between a pro-Chinese, a more Soviet, and a more and a third party, neutralist or independent faction. And there were often struggles for power or for policy decisions between these factions. So Trong Chin was representative of the pro-Chinese faction.
Maybe I think you back down a bit because when you speak in the microphone closely, then
distortion.
Are you, in essence, in summarizing, saying that Trong Chin was a Maoist?
I think Trong Chin, the Vietnamese Communist Party did not follow the Chinese Communist Party's policies after 1956. They followed all the Chinese Communist Party institutional policies up until 1956. But then, as a result of the Great Leap Forward, as a result of the Hundred Flowers campaign, and that getting out of control and demands for liberalization in Vietnam, they shut down the Hundred Flowers campaign, and they did not go further in subsequent years in copying the Chinese policies such as the Great Leap Forward. To ask the question, would I consider Trong Chin a Maoist? I would say perhaps he was a soft core Maoist, and I would regard the leaders of Democratic Kampuchea as hardcore Maoist in their ideological orientation. That they were inspired by the policies of Mao Zedong.
They were all paying tribute to Mao Zedong thought, but it didn't make the Vietnamese communists or the Vietnamese Marxist-Leninists Maoists. Don't you agree with me?
That's because the Vietnamese ceased to emulate the Chinese after 1956 as a result of their bad experience of Maoism in destabilizing their political control to some extent in 1956. So I think that they stepped back and they tended to go more towards whilst retaining some of the institutions of Maoist China, the basic social institutions, they stopped emulating all the Maoist Chinese policies.
Just to wrap up this point, discussing it because it's very crucial for my client. I will give the reference shortly. The direct quote is to be questioned, but it is incorrect that relating interviews with Nguyen Chia, says that by far the biggest influence on his ideology or his vision of Marxism is Trung Chin. If that is indeed the case, how would you then describe the ideology of Nguyen Chia?
Well, I think that if Nguyen Chia is saying that Trung Chin was the most influential of the Vietnamese communist leaders with regard to him, he's conceding that the Chinese orientation faction of the Vietnamese party was influential on the Cambodian Communist Party. I think that one has to look at what actually happened in the state of democratic Kampuchea to come to a conclusion about whether they are ideological or not and what was the inspiration. And I just find it very hard to avoid the conclusion that Maoist China was the big inspirational influence upon Pol Pot and other members. I don't know if there was a disagreement between Nguyen Chia and Pol Pot. I don't know over these questions. I doubt it. In terms of what I've seen of Nguyen Chia say about Pol Pot, his deference towards Pol Pot, his respect for Pol Pot, there could have been some small differences. But, the Cambodian revolution must be understood in terms of what it actually did, not only in terms of what they actually said.
Now let me move to, let's see if I can squeeze in two more subjects. In your book, 0100102, you speak about the propaganda campaign of the Vietnamese that started right after cutting off of diplomatic relations in 1978. On that same page, you speak about an attempt to legitimize its impending overthrow of the Cambodian communist regime. Most importantly, on 0100881, you speak about a meeting in early 1978 between Vietnam and a Soviet propaganda department delegation. Can you explain what that meeting was about? Who were the members of that Soviet delegation?
អ្នកណាដែលជាសមាជិកប្រតិភូរបស់សូវៀតនោះ
I'm sorry, that detail of the book escapes me for the moment.
ចំណុចលម្អិតរបស់សៀវភៅនេះគឺថាខ្ញុំនឹកមិនឃើញទ
ៅនោះ I understand. But is it fair to say that immediately after the cutting off of the diplomatic relations, the Soviets, I presume also these Germans and others, came in to assist the Vietnamese in their propaganda efforts.
Undoubtedly.
Douglas Pike in 3/2370 also talks about
propaganda certainly Is it something that you would agree with?
And if yes, why? យល់ស្របដែរឬក៏អត់ទេហើយបើសិនជាយល់ស្របតើមូលហេតុអី?
Yes, I would agree with that.
ខ្ញុំយល់ស្របទៅលើចំណុចនេះខ្ញុំគិតថាដោយសារថាវៀតណាម
have a long history of
a
much more detailed history of training by the Soviets and the Chinese.
ដែលថាវៀតណាមត្រូវបានទទួលការបណ្ដុះបណ្ដាលពីសម្រាប
់
ប្រទេសចិននិងប្រទេសសូវៀត Now មេតាវី
allow me to fast forward to the present.
អនុញ្ញាតឲ្យខ្ញុំសួរពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងអំពីបញ្ហាវិទ្យាសាស្ត្រនយោបាយមកដល់នឹងសប្តាហ៍នេះតើលោកនៅតែសិក
្សា
គោលនយោបាយបរទេសរបស់រុស្ស៊ីតទៅទៀតដែរឬទេហើយតើតើការឃោសនាពីសំណាក
់ disinformation campaignsfor instance when it comes to Ukraine or Syria
ឧទាហរណ៍ពេលដែលនិយាយពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅដល់ប្រទេសអ៊ុយក្រែនឬក៏ប្រទេសសេរីនៅពេលបច្ចុប្បន្ននេះ
Yes I'm certainly paying close attention to
បាទខ្ញុំមានការយកចិត្តទុកដាក់យ៉ាងជិតទៅបំផុតចំពោះការឃោសនាពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងប្រទេសអ៊ុយក្រែនជាពិសេសពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅប្រទេសអ៊ុយក្រែនតែម្ដងមេតាវីតាលោកអាចធ្វើការប្រៀបធៀបរវាង
assisted propagandaការឃោសនា
ពីសំណាក់សូវៀតនៅក្នុងឆ្នាំ78ពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងវៀតណាមកម្ពុជាហើយនឹងពេលបច្ចុប្បន្ននេះបានដែរឬទេ
Well yeah I mean I think that back in 1978 the Soviets were simply repeating the Vietnamese line on CambodiaThe Vietnamese were skillful in their own right in propaganda, education and propaganda. They didn't need the Soviets to teach them as late as 1978. They've been learning it for decades.
And
I think that the Soviets simply followed along with the Vietnamese line because they were aligned.
សូវៀតប្រកាន់យកមេគៀនយោបាយរបស់វៀតណាមដោយសារតែពួកគេទាំងពីរនេះគឺជាសម្ព័ន្ធអាមិត្តនឹងគ្នា
The most puzzling things to me
មេតាវីចំណុចដែលស្មុគស្មាញបំផុតសម្រាប់ខ្ញុំនោះគ
ឺ
ហើយក៏ស្មុគស្មាញសម្រាប់ដតីផងដែរគឺ
Why it was that
had a way
Vietnam
បានជាវៀតណាម
pro-Soviet Stalinist
country.
Why were they believed when it was DK who started
this whole thing?
It was DK that provoked.
Why on earth would you believe these
pro-Soviet Vietnamese?
Had a way ban chia Việt Nam có bật căn dược côn dược bài con trô khang sổ viết bẹp này thủ bình.
Are you asking why would I believe?
លោកសួរថាមិនថាខ្ញុំជឿជាក់ថាអញ្ចឹងហើយចៅប្រុសខ្ញុំក៏យល់មិនច្បាស់ដែរឥឡូវខ្ញុំសូមរៀបចំសំណួរឡើងវិញ
It seems
បើមើលទៅហាក់ដូចដូចជាថា
មិ
នមែនចាប់បាច់តែត្រឹមតែពេលចាប់ផ្ដើមដំបូងទេក៏ប៉ុន្តែពេលក្រោយៗមកទៀតអ្នកសិក្សាស្រាវជ្រាវជាន់ខ្ពស់អ្នក
ទូ
ទៅណាក៏ដោយដែលមានចំណាប់អារម្ម
ណ៍ 75 and 70
នៅវ័យដែលកាត់ឡើងចន្លោះពីឆ្នាំ75ទៅ
77
នេះគឺថាហាក់ដូចជាជឿដល់មិនបាច់មានការកត់សម្គាល់ទេថាវៀតណាមទេជាអ្នកឃោសនាសម្រាប់ជាផលប្រយោជន៍ខាងខ្លួនរបស់ខ្លួន
Could I ask for a clarification of the question? Because I think it changed. I understood Council's first question was why that Cambodia attacked Vietnam first? Or is Council asking what was the motivation for the Vietnamese invasion? Was it those incursions? Those are two very different questions. It'd be clearer, the records.
And characterizing it as propaganda, it's an additional element.
I have no other words than describe this propaganda coming from
pro-Soviet
Vietnamese. But let me rephrase. The far more skillful propaganda campaign of the Vietnamese together with the Soviets
says
it's the CPK and DK who started
the provocation.
Look, we have limited information about what was actually going on between Vietnam and Cambodia. You have just presented the court with a series of documents from Democratic Cambodia, which I presume comes from DC CAM. Certainly, most people will not be familiar with these documents, nor the context. Based upon the little we know, that was the conclusion that was drawn. I don't think it was because of Vietnamese propaganda. I think that people saw the results. Vietnamese propaganda certainly played a role.
But I think that people
couldn't see another explanation.
Then one final follow-up question.
Because the Vietnamese didn't simply overthrow the regime of Democratic Cambodia, but they occupied the country for 10 years and attempted to create a regime in their own image in Cambodia. And therefore, most people regarded the Vietnamese activity as not simply a defensive one, but an offensive one.
Acts of aggression. Not only because of this Soviet veto.
I think that is true. We see in the votes of the General Assembly year after year, a vote against the Vietnamese presence in Cambodia and a demand for Vietnamese troops to withdraw. Those votes increased year after year from after 1979. And I think that this leads to the conclusion that a huge majority of the international community was opposed to the Vietnamese invasion of Cambodia, and particularly the occupation of Cambodia for 10 years.
And my final, very last question, do you agree with me that the invasion was anything but a humanitarian intervention?
we catch in pin moy, a pet pont and then pine ham, and also told that a young man.
Yes, I don't believe that in its intention the Vietnamese invasion was a humanitarian one. I don't think humanitarian values are part of the ethos of the Politburo of the Vietnamese Communist Party. Although there may have been humanitarian worse humanitarian consequences of the invasion, that wasn't the intention.
Thank you, Mr. President. បាទអរគុណលើនេះដល់ពេលសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃត្រង់ហើយអរមានប្រកាសសម្រាប់ចាប់ពីនេះទៅទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង1កន្លះរសៀលនេះសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្រាប់ការមន្ត្រីរដ្ឋបាលការសម្រាប់រួមរាល់កន្លែងសម្រាប់សំរុំចំពោះអ្នកជំនាញនៅក្នុងឡុងពេលសម្រាប់អាហារថ្ងៃត្រង់និងអញ្ជើញគាត់មកកាន់កន្លែងផ្ដល់ថ្ងៃកម្មក្នុងបន្ទប់សម្រាប់ការនេះវិញមានលើនៅវេលាម៉ោង1កន្លះហើយប្រកបរយៈអំពីគំខាំងនងខ្លួនល Xin chào, chào.